Hi, my name is Joris. I'm a member of the Market Insights team, the European Market Insights team of Google, based in the Netherlands. And the story about Gilbert Iveland isn't really true. It's only the other way around. So Gilbert was world champion in free fighting, cage fighting. I saw him actually getting that title 3 months before I had to fight him in competition. So I went into some kind of underground ground fighting competition, and well, 3 months before that, he just knocked the guy down, which looked almost as impressive as he was, and he didn't stand up anymore. And then 3 months later, I met him in competition. I had to fight him, and more or less won by accident. And, because you may have seen that he's quite tattooed and stuff like that. And I just entered the mat, and the fight was lasting for 10 minutes. And the first 8 minutes, I was just reading what's on his body. And I don't know what happened. And then I just stopped reading at some point in time, and he was tired. So I just, we tapped out. So of course, that was okay. My story today is about cross-media, about cross-media ROI and how cross-media are planned. Because you've seen the potential of Belgium moving forward in e-commerce, and there are some forces in cross-media, how cross-media are planned, that basically block online from growing towards its potential as fast as it could. So it's good to know about these forces, especially if you're an e-commerce audience. And I think it's good to know about the cross-media forces to know how to speed up the process of reaching your potential. So my career went actually from a media agency towards an advertising agency, and then I moved into research agencies steering campaigns based on brand effects, advising advertisers about it, particularly the large mass advertisers. And while I was moving towards these jobs, I moved into like all kinds of questions, which I thought, if you look at cross-media as a product to be used by advertisers, then it's actually not really user-friendly. And so I have some questions here that just popped in my mind, and they also are in the media a lot, and they are not being solved. And it's good to know that, because there are also the potential for growth is there for e-commerce to solve these issues. So I will take you to those questions, and then finally I will move towards a phase where actually the problems are going to solve itself, but in between we have to speed it up ourselves. So this slide is depicting two types of worlds, basically. So you have on the top, you have clicks, impressions, conversions. It's the language that you all know. And at the bottom, you have demographic targeting. You have GRPs. Probably it's something people know, but it's a currency that you use to buy time on TV or radio. Frequency, reach, things like that. And those are two totally different languages, which I find strange, because an advertiser doesn't want to buy a part of his campaign there in one language, and then another part of his campaign somewhere else in another language, and then again another part of his campaign somewhere else again in another language. It's not user friendly. And I think it blocks optimal cross-media planning. And the gap in between is pretty large. It's a gap that's called ROI. The metrics on the top, you have clicks and conversions, they are a form of ROI, but they are a very small part of the ROI, and I have some slides later explaining why I think this is such a small part. And the metrics at the bottom, I think actually none of them is about ROI. It's only about building reach and having a contact with a person, which basically means that the commercial was there when the TV was on and the person was in the room. It says nothing about how impactful it was, or even that it was noticed. So the question that came into my mind is why don't we have a common language for all media? Because the advertisers are asking for it all the time. And well, across media is there a pretty long time now. It's still not there. Would be a lot easier. And also, why is that not something like a cross-media planning tool? We have the audience research for radio in one panel, and we have it for TV in another panel with different techniques. We have it for online, again in another panel, also with different techniques. We have it for outdoor. In the Netherlands, it was done 15 years ago and never repeated since. So we have information about media being measured in all separate kinds of stuff, and it's not merged into one planning tool. Doesn't make sense. Now here, I move to the part where I think I can show that the impact that we look at when we look at e-commerce and look at online conversions is actually just a very small part of the impact. This is what online is really, really good at. So you have the ad contact on the top. Someone clicks and buys online within the next 30 days. And we can measure this amazingly well. We can even put multiple ads in one ad group and have it rotate automatically and have the best one, the best converting one, appear more often than the other ones. But for offline, that would be amazing. Just take 5 TV commercials, you don't want to know which one is the best one, and you say, well, let's just add them all, and the best one will automatically appear. Will never happen within the next 5 years on TV. So this is really, really cool, and it's really good. But this is already a lot more difficult to measure. So you have an ad contact, and the person does not click. He does all kinds of stuff. So there's clearly something happened in his mind. So there's a brand effect, basically, or a recall effect. And because of that, he decides to search in another time when he chooses it himself or visits the website straight away and then buys it online product. So the effect is still evoked by the ad contact, but it's not appearing in the systems that we use to measure impact or conversions. And this is even harder. So you have the ad contact and again, there's a brand effect, something happening in the mind. And then orientation, maybe, and the person decides to buy something offline. Also not appearing in your systems of conversion tracking. And I think that, about 3% of all retail worldwide is online. And the estimates are that about 33 to 45, depends a bit on how you look at it, of all the purchases in retail is influenced by online. So it means that the impact that's on the right of the graph, the things we don't see in our systems, is actually a lot larger than the things we see in our systems. Approximately, we are looking now at 10% of the total effect. And it will be different across categories. Some will be low, some will be a lot higher. And Henry is going to elaborate a little bit more on this ROPO effect, which we call research online purchase offline. But it's very clear we are looking at a very small part of the total effect. And I think this is one of the main reasons why online taps mainly out of e-commerce budgets. And not very much, and not as much as it could, from branding budgets, which are really large. So here's really potential for growth, improving the full impact of online advertising. Now this graph, it is based on about 150 campaigns that I tracked when I was doing being a consultant for advertisers. We were tracking the brand impact of campaigns, measuring whether they worked or not, and then based on that we would decide what is the weakest link in the campaign, try to fix it, and then measure again if the campaign is working better. And what I summarized here are the most common reasons for campaign failure. Well, on the top you see 10%. This is the number of campaigns that is perfect. So these are the campaigns where the full funnel starts moving during the campaign, and it's just nothing to optimize. So it's only 10% of the campaigns that just do exactly what you want them to do. And we have this quote that is used a lot about 50% of the budget being wasted. That's quite an optimistic quote. And it's also from quite a long time ago, when media planning was a lot more simple. So it's logic that it is optimistic compared to what we have now. Then you have about 15% of the campaigns not working because of some kind of strategy flaw, which means if you look at the impact, what you see happening is that people remember that they saw the campaign, they remember the message, they remember what brand it was for, maybe even the brand awareness is increasing, maybe even brand image, but then it's already starting to stop. But on the level of consideration, preference or purchase, nothing is happening. If you have a pattern like that, it mostly means that you're trying to claim something which you cannot claim with your brand. Or you're trying to claim something which is not relevant for the consumer. So he notices it, he understands it, but it doesn't trigger any intention to buy your product. You cannot fix that problem on a creative level. You have to fix it on a strategy level. And you can also not fix that problem on a media strategy level. Oh, it's maybe a little bit too early. So at the bottom, you have three parts. It's like a total of 50% of all the reasons of campaign failure. And those are all creative. 20% of campaigns is not working because they are not noticed at all. That's a creative problem. So you show them the commercial, you show them the advertising, you show them whatever, and they just don't remember having seen it, even though being exposed maybe 10 times. That's a creative problem. So the concept is just not good enough to attract enough attention to remember something about it. And then you have 20% where people remember actually that they saw the ad, but they don't know what brand it was for. So it's not likely it's going to impact any of the fundamental levels of your brand's brand funnel. Also a creative problem. Can't fix that with media planning. It's just a creative problem. And then you have 10% where people just don't understand the message. So they recall the ad, they know the brand, but they don't recall what product it was about or what feature it was about. Again, creative problem. Can't be fixed with media planning. And then you have 1/4 of the pile which you actually can fix with media planning. And 20%, the biggest part, is shattering of budget, is what I call it. It's mostly caused by the fact that offline media are planned based on reach, and reach builds a lot faster than impact. So if you have a planning system saying, well, we reached 90% of people 3 times with the TV commercial, we reached 80% of the people 3 times with the print ad, and maybe we reached 40% of the people 5 times with radio, then it's supposed to be okay. But if you look at the same material from an impact perspective, then effects have actually not started building. So shattering is done in many ways. It's too many messages in one campaign, shattering a small budget over too many media, so you don't reach the critical mass to be effective in one medium. It's too many messages over time, switching campaign concepts too fast over time. Happens a lot and even all at the same time. And there's 5% of the campaigns fails because reach and frequency is not good, or targeting is demographically not right. It's actually very good because the planning systems are extremely good at this. But if you want to increase your scope of influence, you need to move to ROI-based planning, which will make you shatter the budget less. And if you really want to increase your scope of influence, you need to embed creative quality in your decision making. So a media agency should actually say, well, I see this radio commercial has a problem, and I will not tune your media strategy unless you fix a creative problem first, because it's a waste of energy. And they mostly don't say that. And the nice thing about online iterates based on clicks. And that automatically means that you integrate creative strategy a little bit, because the best creatives have the best clicks. And the only problem is that the click is just this very small part of the total effect. So it might be that best best performing creative on clicks is not the best performing creative on the total effect in that other 90%. Well, if you add brand synergy, in total you would have 18 times more influence on the outcome of the campaign than when you only plan on reaching frequency, like most advertisers actually do when they plan offline. And I'm talking about offline a lot, even though you're an e-commerce audience, because I think you need to understand how the offline people think. Because that's the only way how you can shift branding budgets towards online. You need to see the limits of their thinking. So the question that popped into my mind is, why don't we integrate media creative and brand strategy better? That's one thing I would like to ask you. I've always been surprised that the media plan is actually created without knowing what kind of creative strategy is coming. And then you work with the advertising agency and they say, well, we're doing radio, we're doing audio, we're doing TV, and online, you create the materials. And no advertiser actually briefs the media and the creative agency at the same time. So how many advertisers do we have in this room? Can you stick up your hand? So not very much. No advertisers at all? Is there anyone that briefs this media agency at the same time as the creative agency? That's good. That's at least, well, it's approximately 20% of the hands that point up. I think every advertiser should do it, and not only brief them at the same time, but also have them get back together on the table during the process a few times to make sure that creative and media strategy are optimally aligned. And my last question, because the creative and brand strategy part are such a large pie of the influence on the outcome, these things are actually unpredictable. They're different every single time. Media planning things, you can create models of that and then predict what will come out. That the creative part is unpredictable. So the only way to really plan well on ROI is if you start measuring and then iterating. So see what works, what doesn't work, and then adjust your campaigns. The only way to really be good at ROI. You can't expect to plan and then have everything to happen according to plan. So if you summarize it, I think these three questions actually are popping up in the Netherlands in a lot of articles. People want a common currency for all media, they want integrated planning tools, and they want ROI-based planning and iteration. At least they're asking for ROI-based planning, and I tell them that you need to iterate if you want to be ROI-based. Well, in Germany and the Netherlands, we are building single-source panels, and I will make this very short because I don't have a lot of time. And in these single-source panels, we measure all the media consumption of people. We measure how they think about brands, we measure their orientation behavior, and we measure the purchase behavior. So this is a panel that actually has all media in one panel and all the impact parameters that you would want in the same panel. And these are the types of platforms that you need to have the market transfer to these new ways of looking at cross-media ROI. And then you can validate the relative value of the impressions that you're buying. Right now, the GRP is based on just an impression, regardless of how impactful that was. So a pre-roll impression is the same as a TV impression, is the same as a basic banner or a text ad. That's strange. So you need to correct that impression for how well it's targeted. You need to correct that impression for how much impact it had on brand, on orientation, or on purchase. And if you do that, then you move towards what I call cost per ERP, which is effect rating point, cost per meaningful contact. That could be the common currency that we all use in cross-media planning, and would be a lot more simple for advertisers to use. Well, I will move forward a little bit. So, we can fix with this single source panel the first two problems. So we can fix the common currency, we can create integrated planning tools with these panels, but we cannot iterate on ROI because cross-media is too complex for that. You would need a tracking system of 5,000 people a week and then analyze cross media all the time and then adjust. No one can pay that. But the problem will solve itself. But it takes quite a long time. TV is moving to IP, so it becomes fragmented, which makes it even harder to be successful. But interaction is possible, so TV becomes online. And I think if you're a TV planner and you don't learn about online, you will lose your job in 5 years' time from now. Whereas if you're an online planner and you don't learn about offline, it just means that you move forward not as fast as you can think with moving branding budgets to e-commerce, but you will not lose your time, your job in the long term. Well, what can happen? Outdoor poster, create a picture that your camera recognizes the posters as well. Browse the online shop. Then you choose to buy it online, or you say, well, let's see what shops have in store, what the prices are, navigate towards it. And what happens is that you have all kinds of behaviors that you can measure passively that constitute a brand funnel. And you can validate the value of these behaviors. So, well, what's the financial value of a picture of an outdoor poster? What is the financial value of an online shop visit? What would be the financial value if the person puts the shoe in his image, posts it on Facebook, and says to his friend, how do these shoes look for me? Do you think it looks nice? And then the friend says, I like it. What's the financial value of that? And the friend actually decides to forward the product of the picture to another friend, says, well, these are cool shoes. So what's the financial value of that? The person starts searching generic or branded. If it's generic, you're more or less in the consideration level. If it's branded, it's, well, moving towards a preference already. So it has a different financial value. And then an offline store visit. You can also track that passively by just tracking someone's phone information. If you have a brand funnel in these passively measurable online behaviors, you don't have to use questionnaires anymore. You can have a brand tracker of maybe 100,000 people per week linked directly to the ads that you're actually using. So you can follow on, well, real time, the impact of your ads. And it's way beyond the click, because these behaviors are just a full brand funnel. And I think all advertisers should try to validate their behavioral brand funnel and try to find financial value of each relevant behavior and try to see how you trigger it. And it's possible if you have single source panels, you have all the behaviors that people do, and you have all their purchases, so you know the relation to purchase, and you know the average value of the purchase, so you know the value of the behavior. Well, some examples here, I will move through them quickly. This could be a brand tracker of the future. So we have it's insights for search. So we have iSwatch versus Swatch. You see iSwatch taking over Swatch. We have Pixar doing promotion with Delhaize. We have something here. Fortis going to online banking. And finally, we have something here, which is Bart De Wever versus Di Rupo. Di Rupo apparently being popular in Antwerp, Luxembourg, Brussels, and Henegouwen. You can imagine that this tracker, right now it's only search behavior, but you can imagine that this tracker has all these behaviors in it that I just showed, and the ones that are specifically useful for your market. And you know the financial value of each behavior, and it's linked also to your advertising. I think that's ROI-based advertising. And technically, I believe it's possible in about 5 years from now. But to be honest, it will take at least 10 years, maybe more, depending on how hard we push our offline colleagues with argumentation, because they don't like to do ROI research. They don't like it as much as we do. Because they don't like the confrontation of seeing that the ad was not good and it cost like $500,000, and they don't want to be confronted like that because you can lose your job over it. I think 50,000 euro for a cross media analysis is expensive, which is strange because I spent over 5 million a year, and most of it is actually not working. and I still don't want to buy cross-media analysis for 50,000 euros. Strange. And media, cross-media becomes more complex if you move to ROI, because it changes all the time. So in Dutch we have a nice word for it, it's called ostrich politics. And struisvogel politiek. I think that's basically what they are doing. And well, we can help them by bringing this message to them. Say, refuse to pay for waste. Because the advertisers really have to push this. The agencies are not going to do it because they earn money from the current system. And the media owners, they own all the audience research and they earn money from that as well. So the advertisers have to push this. And within the advertisers, it's the online people that have to push this. So you say, refuse to pay for waste. Be willing to pay for more quality, which means you have to quantify what quality for you is. So quantify these behaviors, quantify the brand funnel, add financial values to it, and add financial values to it, and measure. Allow your agency to transform the business model, because it's now not based on ROI. So you need to be, well, you can't squeeze them out on the lowest cost per GRB and then expect them to plan on ROI. It's just not working like that. Integrate media creative and brand strategies. So start briefing them at the same time and keeping them together all the time. And then finally, integrate behavior in your models like I just described. And I think I'm ready now. So basically tell your colleagues to move forward, think e-commerce and get their heads out of the ground. And that's the end of my story.